Governor, Chancellor, President Draghi, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Guildhall. And may I say on behalf of the City London Corporation, what a pleasure it is to host this fantastic forum. Only 48 hours left as Lord Mayor, but what a way to bring the year to a close. One of the highlights was the banker's dinner at the Mansion House back in June. Giddy with his recent electoral success, the Chancellor kicked off with a joke about former Prime Minister Lord Palmerston doing something unmentionable on a billiards table. Poor old Palmerston. But my sympathy was tempered on reading one of his letters to a close friend written on the 3rd of April, 1858, in which he moaned, "I've been invited to dine with the Lord Mayor on Monday. A terrible man and a great deal of effort. It frightens me more than the budget." 150 years on, Chancellor, we Lord Mayors are a changed bunch. Men of the people and always ready to talk about what's going on in the financial services sector and discussing our position in society. That's precisely the role of the Bank of England's Open Forum. When financial services work as they should, they drive prosperity, they generate jobs, they create wealth, and they channel it into the economy. They feed every single sector, developing businesses and nurturing an entrepreneurial culture. But when they don't work as they should, we have a problem. At that dinner in June, the Chancellor, the Governor, and I all spoke of the changing nature of the sector, the incredibly positive ways that we've moved on since 2007, and the successes that have followed. The wealth created, the time given, the people supported, the excellent services that are offered to clients of all types, the improved resilience of financial markets. My own view is that all firms across the financial services and every other sector have to make sure that they are properly engaged in society with constructive, cohesive policies on how they get involved in the community. With that in mind, City Giving Day on the 30th of September shone a spotlight on some of the terrific stories across the square mile and beyond. I have spent 43 years of my life in financial services, and I can tell you that this is such a fantastic development. It's a chance for us to change the narrative, particularly around the sector, pulling out that British cultural stopper and stopping the market from working properly, and making sure that people see what goes unseen and also underappreciated. That change is supported by the work going on around regulation, work like the Fair and Effective Markets Review, or FEMA, written by the Bank of England, the FCA, and the HM Treasury. It was a great review, and I'm proud to say the City of London Corporation has backed it all the way. Calling it a fresh start misses the point. It's far more significant than that. It's reform, keeping the best of the old and adding the best of the new, engaging management and practitioners in a positive way and getting them to understand and embrace their very real and very important responsibilities rather than raining down thunderbolts of unrealistic regulation. It's like the old Heineken advert. Managers can reach the parts that regulators can't. So regulators must seek the support of practitioners, working together and ending up in the right place. Not light regulation, but the right regulation. Now, with FEMA properly bedded in, we should take stock on the reform so far and make sure that all the overall regulatory environment is both realistic and robust, not just for now, but the future too. Developments like the Capital Markets Union and the new FinTech represent the future of finance. We should encourage them to make sure that they're able to fuel innovation, growth, and the top-notch services we give to our clients and everybody else, doing it with an understanding that we have to be internationally competitive. That's how we build a better brand, a better economy, and a better society. And with that collegiate spirit in mind, this open forum will provide a platform for the full range of voices, from regulators to politicians, to practitioners and to the public. All those voices will be heard, and they will also listen. They will learn, and hopefully based on the content of this forum, they will act. I hope you all enjoy the day. Thank you. It's now my great pleasure to hand you over to the Governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney.
Chancellor, President Draghi, Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Open Forum. I'd like to begin by thanking you, Lord Mayor, for your extraordinary service over the past year, almost the past year, and the extraordinary service to come over the next 48 hours, and to thank you for your gracious hospitality today here in a building that started life in 1411 as a, quote, little cottage, and which has become the place to bring people together, whether it's livery companies and businesses, traders and market makers, world leaders and citizens. This has been the place that's brought together people to solve problems. Today we're drawing inspiration from this great tradition by gathering representatives from across civil society to discuss how to build the real markets of tomorrow. Now, the Bank of England is here as a convener. We have a statutory responsibility to protect and enhance the stability of the financial system of the United Kingdom. So even if we don't regulate all aspects of financial markets per se, we have a close interest in working with others to create the markets that enjoy the trust of society whilst efficiently allocating capital and risk. And that's because markets are powerful drivers of prosperity and security for all. Financial markets in particular matter. By financing firms to hire, invest, and expand, markets drive growth. By opening up cross-border trade and investment, they create new opportunities for our businesses and investors. By transferring risks to those who are most willing and able to bear them, markets help households and investors to insure against the unexpected. Indeed, markets are becoming ever more important as individuals bear increasing responsibility for financing their retirements and insuring against risks. So it's vital that markets work well, and it's vital that they are seen to do so. Only real markets can deliver all these benefits. Real markets are resilient. They don't collapse when the going gets tough. Real markets are fair. They have participants who compete on merit, not collude online. Real markets aren't ends in themselves, but means to much greater ends. So it's only the markets that transparently serve the real economy that can retain the trust of society. In other words, only real markets have social license. And the crisis and its aftermath laid bare that many of our markets didn't live up to these standards. At times, some of the most important fixed income, currency, and commodity markets proved fragile, unfair, ineffective, and unaccountable. So it's hardly surprising that only a third of people believe markets work in the interests of society. And also, the more people see, the less they like. People tend to trust markets less with age. And yet, at the same time, most people think that markets will become ever more important. And they're right. As I wrote this week to G20 leaders, the structure of the global financial system has changed significantly since the crisis. Virtually all of the net capital raised since the crisis has been through the capital markets. And the size of assets under management has increased in the last 5 years by more than 60% to just about $75 trillion. Now, real markets don't just happen, they depend on the quality of infrastructure. And that means the hard infrastructure, or the plumbing that determines the mechanics of markets, and the soft infrastructure, like standards and codes that define how market participants behave. And that robust market infrastructure is a public good, and like many public goods, it risks being undersupplied. If we take it for granted, that infrastructure that supports markets won't keep pace with their dynamism, just as it failed to do in the run-up to the crisis, and we all have a responsibility to prevent that from happening again. And that's why we're so delighted that so many people are here today, joining those who've already participated in panels in Manchester and Cambridge. We're pleased that we'll be hearing from others who are attending parallel forums in Birmingham and Edinburgh, and those who are already sharing their comments, ideas, and thoughts and questions on social media. As the Lord Mayor indicated, for the first time what we're doing is we're bringing together people who are on all sides of markets. So it's not just the bankers and central bankers and regulators and traders, but the companies, the investors, the savers, the academics, the judges, the trade unionists, and the journalists. And that's obviously important because we all rely on markets and we're all affected by them. Now, the good news is that this process of rebuilding real markets has been underway for some time. Over the course of the past 7 years, there's been a huge program of reform that's worked to fix the fault lines that led to the crisis and to build more resilient market-based sources of finance to serve the real economy. And the UK has very much played a leading role, consistent with the UK's position as the preeminent global financial center. After all, 40% of global foreign exchange trading goes through London. Half of all OTC derivatives are traded in the UK. 2/3 of trading in international bond. More international banking activity is booked here than anywhere else. UK efforts have made great strides in making the system more resilient. The banks that sit at the center of the system are safer. Their capital requirements have been increased tenfold, and their liquid assets on balance sheets have increased 4 times. There's a new simple leverage ratio in place that protects the system from risks that we think are low, but in fact are not. Banks' trading assets have fallen by 1/3 since the crisis. Their interbank borrowings have been cut in half. And banks' newfound resilience has been demonstrated recently as they've dampened rather than amplified short-lived but significant financial market volatility. Of course, those banks must be more resilient because they can no longer rely on the support of the state. This week, the FSB proposed to G20 leaders a landmark agreement on total loss absorbing capacity, which is central to ending too big to fail in banks. Once implemented, it will ensure that large financial institutions can fail without disrupting the system or on calling on taxpayers to bail them out. So this era of heads I win, tails you lose capitalism is drawing to a close. Authorities are also working, as the Lord Mayor indicated, to end this tide of ethical drift. Market benchmarks have been reformed to end abuse. And most importantly, market participants are being made more accountable for their actions. Misconduct is being met with genuine penalties. And by holding individuals accountable, authorities are ending the age of irresponsibility. The best in the industry are playing a leading role by getting the FIC Market Standard Board up and running. Now, this is a board which is establishing clearly understood standards, keeping them up to date with market developments and promoting adherence. And in parallel, the Banking Standards Board is promoting higher standards of conduct and competence across the UK banking sector. To give these measures teeth, Her Majesty's government is extending the senior managers regime to all firms in FIC markets and putting them on a common basis with banks and insurers. And this means that being a senior manager in finance now brings the responsibility and accountability that the best in the industry have long recognized, that finance is a true profession. The Bank of England has been comprehensively overhauling our approach to markets. We're replacing constructive ambiguity with open for business when providing liquidity to markets. And we're working with others as one bank to develop the markets that support financial stability and the real economy. We've revamped our governance, and we're holding ourselves to the highest standards of accountability, including applying the senior manager's regime to the bank on top of regular parliamentary and public scrutiny. So a huge amount has already been achieved to make markets fairer, more resilient, more accountable, and more effective. And these reforms are all essential for the UK to remain the leading international financial center. They're essential not least because the size of our markets is already 6 times the size of UK GDP, and it's likely to grow to up to 15 times by 2050. Now, the journey of reform isn't finished, but today is very much a chance to take stock and reflect, not just on those achievements, but on what we might have missed, what we might have overdone, or what we might have simply got wrong. It has to be said that given the scale and the complexity of the reform process, it would be remarkable if every single measure were perfectly constructed, or if they all fit seamlessly into a totally coherent, self-reinforcing whole. So authorities, including the bank, must have the courage to listen, the honesty to admit mistakes when they've been made, and the confidence to set them right. Because what we're determined to do, along with the FCA and the Treasury and others, is not to repeat the cycles of the past when there were bursts of post-crisis reforms that would eventually drift into complacency and cohabitation. In these times, the caravan would move on, markets would be left unattended to slip slowly into excess and ethical drift. So we want to not only profile today the progress that has been made in reforming markets, but to spur this continual process of review. This isn't just about fixing the fault lines of the last crisis. It's also about seizing new opportunities from fintech and market-based finance. And it's about building truly global markets in the UK and elsewhere with the cross-border governance and cooperation structures that they need to function well. So it's precisely because we don't know all the answers, we're asking questions such as what more needs to be done? Are there gaps in place that could allow markets to go wrong again? Or are there other places where the pendulum has swung too far, preventing markets from serving society as they should? We want to hear from those who might question the steps already taken. We welcome new ideas that challenge conventions on how markets should operate and whose eyes are fixed on the future of markets. And of course, we're sorry there couldn't be more people physically here today. We were four times oversubscribed for places. But I trust those unable to come are following us through social media, on the web, and will interact throughout the day. They'll be joined by some of the 5,000 pupils from over 300 schools who watched our webinar earlier this week. Because after all, those students are the ones who will reap the rewards and bear the consequences of financial reforms. And they'll be the ultimate judges of our efforts. Our first speaker today has set out clearly the standards against which those judgments should be made. And I'm going to quote from something he said 5 months ago. 5 years from now, UK financial services will be the best regulated in the world, with markets of unquestioned integrity and the highest standards of conduct. There'll be more competition, more innovation, and more players in retail markets offering customers a better service. There will be new firms disrupting the status quo, and big firms raising their game in response, with Britain leading the fintech revolution. A fair challenge. Please join me in welcoming the Chancellor of the Exchequer, the Right Honourable George Osborne, to the stage to begin the debate.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Well, Mark, thank you very much for that introduction, and congratulations to you and the bank for this fantastic initiative. Well done for getting the permission of the Lord Mayor to host it all in this brilliant building, the Guild Hall. And it's good to see the President of the European Central Bank here, Mario Draghi. It's not the first time the Italians have been here. This was the site of the big Roman amphitheatre when the Romans were running our country. And we're having quite a debate about our relationship with Europe at the moment. This was also, as Mark alluded to in his remarks, the site of the medieval government of London. This was the centre of a nascent democracy as people started to assert their rights as citizens of this city against the crown. Although you should be aware that the meaning of the word Guild Hall is where citizens came to pay their guild, in other words, where citizens turned up to pay their taxes. So you're all very welcome here today. But seriously, I think what the what the bank is trying to do here today, not just in this room, but through the similar forums happening in Birmingham and Edinburgh, through the interaction with the schools that have been taking part in the webinar, I think you called it, Mark, that's a new word for me, and the interaction on the social media, and the fact that many people here are members of the public who applied for tickets through a public ballot. I think this is really an outstanding initiative by a central bank. It builds on the work that Eddie George did in making the minutes transparent, Mervyn King did in taking that further, of course, as an independent central bank, and the regular press conferences and the like that started to be held. But I congratulate you, Mark, and your team on this latest attempt to make sure that what you do, which of course has such an impact on people's lives, is properly understood. And as you say, you are open to criticism, to constructive conversation, to new ideas and new thinking, and that you take the effort to explain exactly what you are doing in the bank. And of course, that approach of being accountable and open is something that is incredibly important in our financial markets as well. And let's be clear, we are emerging from an age when for too long, benchmarks, it turns out, were rigged by insiders, benchmarks that were used by millions of people when they exchanged their money when they went on holiday, or they, as a company, had a derivative to protect themselves against foreign exchange exposure. It now turns out the insiders were rigging the benchmark. We had a situation where, for a variety of reasons, banking monopolies were throttling outsiders, new entrants. Banks said that they were well capitalized and, of course, turned out not to be. Regulators said they knew exactly what was going on, and of course they did not. And I think it's a sign of how far we've come as a country over the last 5, 6, 7 years since the crash, that we can have this open conversation about what went wrong and how we want to fix it. And I congratulate you, Mark, on bringing together such an incredibly diverse range of participants in the various conversations you're going to have today, not just top people in finance and president of the central bank and the chair of some of our biggest banks in the world, the chairs of some of the biggest banks in the world, but also religious leaders, trade unionists, people from civil society, as I say, members of the public, people who are, as you mentioned, at the forefront of the fintech revolution, and of course, the odd politician. So we all bring a different perspective, different responsibilities to this conversation today. But one thing we all share in common is that we as customers rely on a financial system that works well for us. We borrow and save in our own lives at different points of our life cycle. We save for pensions. We take out mortgages to buy a home. And those investments that we make in our own future, our savings, of course, are channeled into, through the financial system, the small business that is going to start up, the bigger business that wants to expand. And it's an absolutely central part of not just the economy, but our society. And in the United Kingdom, I think we've got a particular dilemma which we seek to try and resolve. We want our financial firms to take risks, to innovate, to create jobs, to fund businesses. And we want to be, very much want to be, the home of the world's largest financial center. We want to be the home of the world's largest banks. But at the same time, of course, we want those banks to be safe. We want those markets to be safe. When problems arise, we want those institutions to be able to cope. We want them to be self-reliant without leaning on the taxpayer to bail them out. And we are meeting in the country which had the largest single bank bailout in the world 7 years ago. And of course, that created a huge amount of public anger and anxiety about the future. And it is remarkable how far collectively we have come these last 6 or 7 years. Let's remember where we were back then. The regulations, the regulators had failed. We were told the banks would be able to cope. They couldn't. The government of the day had to step in, spend billions of pounds of taxpayers' money bailing those banks out. At the same time, it threw a spotlight on a financial system where banking competition had evaporated. The number of clearing banks in our society, I know something you're going to be talking about later, had dwindled from 16 major banks in the 1960s to just four by 2010. And if you take those big banks together, they had close to 80% of customer banking by 2010. All those building societies that were such a feature of our finance a few decades ago had either demutualized or were merged in the process of rescuing them during the crisis. And the new entrants at least felt they had to, although of course turned out to be a catastrophic mistake, had to offer very attractive and ultimately unsustainable financial products to break into this monopoly. And that's what HBOS and Northern Rock were attempting to do when, of course, they failed. As I say, in the end, the public had to pick up the bill. And it became, I think, mingled with an anger about the rewards in financial services. People had always been told these were risky professions and you got paid as a result. And then when the crunch came, it felt like they were bailed out and bailed out by taxpayers who didn't have much say over the whole thing. And then, of course, there were the real consequences for the economy, some of which are still being felt today. The credit crunch, the withdrawal of finance from small businesses who didn't really have any other options to go beyond the banking system, which remains one of the big challenges across Europe, including in the UK, and something we're trying to solve with the Capital Markets Union in the European Union. And on top of all of that, just as we were reeling from all of that, we were hit by the LIBOR scandal. The world's most important benchmark rate, it turned out, had been manipulated, and then we discovered subsequently that foreign exchange markets too had been manipulated. And of course, the exposure of the emails and the telephone conversations and the like that went on between some of the market traders just reinforced a sense that the financial markets were not working with people. For people. So we've done a huge amount to try and turn that around. In fact, looking around this room, I see so many people who have made a huge contribution to trying to achieve that. Our regulation is stronger. We've taken a big decision in this country to put banking regulation back in the hands of our central bank and give it a big responsibility there. Not just to regulate individual financial institutions like banks and insurance firms, but also to take a look at the wider systemic risks in an economy, so that as well as being our monetary authority, they're also our macroprudential authority and can warn us when they see risks emerging in something like the housing market. Our banks are much safer, as Mark was just saying, much better capitalized than they were. Of course, that. In one sense, you might think comes at a price because they have less capacity to lend, so the charge goes. I would say a better capitalized bank is a much better institution for everyone concerned in the financial system, including the small business that depends on their loans and depends on those loans not being withdrawn when it turns out they're not particularly well capitalized. We're much more transparent now about how those markets are regulated, how much people are paid at the top of our financial institutions. And of course, we have public stress tests, both conducted in this country and of course conducted by the European Central Bank. And frankly, in the end, the person doing my job, hopefully it won't be me when this happens, but whoever is doing my job when the next big bank failure happens, has more options than my predecessor had. Because on the night when the Royal Bank of Scotland failed, Alistair Darling, it turned out, had very few options but to bail it out. And he didn't have the legal powers he needed. He was worried about the ability of the ATMs the next morning to go on paying out banknotes. He was concerned about what would happen to the retail banking functions more broadly. And in the end, the option he felt that he had in front of him, the only option, was to bail that bank out. And I want to make sure that whoever is sitting in that seat the next time something like that happens has many more options. The bank is much better capitalized. It has been regulated by a central bank that has gone through its resolution plan. In other words, it knows what the bank's going to do if it starts to get into trouble. We can bail in the creditors. Rather than have to bail in the taxpayers, we have the legal powers, not just at a national level, but a European level, to address the problem. And in the end, the taxpayer is protected from that failure. We also see much more competition now emerging in our banking system, new entrants into our onto the high street, the return of some old names like TSB and Williams and Glynn, and that's great news. And I know that Andrew Bailey, our excellent chief executive of the Prudential Regulatory Authority, has written today to my colleague, the city minister in the Treasury, about what the bank and the PRA are going to do to help level the playing field even more for the challenger banks, both within Europe and domestically, how we're going to work in Europe to have a more proportionate separate regime for some of the small challenger banks so they find it easier to get going. And that here at home, we're going to look at things like the internal rating system we use and making sure that the smaller banks have a better chance to get going. And we're also becoming a more and more competitive place to do business. London has just overtaken New York to become the world's most competitive financial center on the international index that is produced of these things. And we want to keep it this way. And I would make actually another observation, a European observation. I think it is massively in the interests of not just Britain, but the whole European Union, that one of the world's big financial centers is located within the European Union and not located in New York or in Asia. And that not just the pound, but the euro is traded through a large financial center here in Europe. We're also looking to create new markets. We've got the Prime Minister of India turning up in this country this week, and we are working with him and his government on what we can do to support the offshore Indian bond market. We've just had the President of China here, and of course we have become the Western center for the trading of the renminbi. And that is not only good for us as a financial center and the jobs and the investment that brings, it's good for those countries as they attract the investment they need to bring prosperity, more prosperity to their population. And of course, we want to be the great innovation center of the future, the fintech center, as it's called. You know, this week I met Tim Cook, the chief executive of Apple, who was in London. And we spent a lot of the time talking about Apple Pay, the new system where you can pay with your mobile phone. And I was thinking how extraordinary it was that you had a finance minister and the head of a tech company talking about the future of banking. And that is, of course, the shape of things to come. And I am absolutely clear about this. I want the UK to be the global center of fintech. And we will go out of our way to make that happen here in Britain. We're the first government in the world taking a serious look at digital currencies. These were once dismissed. They may now well play a big part in our financial future as a globe. We are making sure that our regulators are providing the space where new innovation can happen so that the rules don't frustrate that ambition. And we are today, I can tell you, working with EY to undertake a benchmarking exercise to see just how we compare as a fintech center with other centers around the world and what we can do to build on our existing competitive advantage. So there's a lot of change happening, a lot of change that is essentially designed to have a financial system that works better for you, for the people of this country who rely on banks and building societies and savings accounts and mortgages and pensions and small business loans to fulfill your dreams and aspirations in life. And working together, I think we can deliver that solution to that British dilemma, how we have an innovative, exciting global banking center while at the same time protecting people in this country for when that banking system has problems. So thank you for inviting me to this open forum. I was supposed to give a speech and take no questions, but then I pointed out it was supposed to be an open, interactive forum. So please, let's have some questions. Thank you. Who's got some questions? Well, actually, are there a couple people behind you, actually? Hold on. If we take the first one, the gentleman at the back there. And then I'll come to you, sir.
Hi, Nick Hungerford from Nutmeg. You just talked right then about financial technology, and obviously that's a key part of what we'll be talking about today to restore trust in financial services. New companies with cultures of transparency perhaps competing and winning, with some have seemingly lost those values. We think we're the number one country in the world for fintech, and you've just outlined some things that you have been doing, but you're the man with the money. So what are we going to do in the future to keep their status? Because the people I talk to in Silicon Valley think it's only a matter of time until they take the number one spot back.
Yeah. Well, I think the interesting thing is that in the end, to succeed in fintech, you need to be good at both fin and tech. Right, and Silicon Valley obviously is a fantastic center of technology, although actually this city has become a great tech center in recent years, and some of the most exciting tech in the world is happening here. We also, I think, we have the financial expertise, and I think our challenge is to bring the two together. And of course, you know, it would be foolish for a politician to think that they know what all the answers are. The whole point is we've got to create the space where this innovation can happen. And that's partly about understanding where we are in the world, and that's what this exercise, doing the benchmarking exercise so that we can respond potentially in the budget next year with changes to our tax and regulatory system. So, for example, ISAs are becoming open at the moment as a result of decisions we took to, things like peer-to-peer lending and funding circles. So we're taking a regulated consumer product and making it open to brand new technology-enabled forms of lending. The PRA and the FCA are, particularly the FCA, creating space where new products can be tried out, which in a sort of safe regulatory environment without immediately being suffocated by rules designed for another kind of banking system. And we're always looking at how we can use the tax system to encourage entrepreneurial activity and the growth of these businesses. So I think you're right that the race is on, but we're determined to win it. Let's take another question there, sir.
Hello, I'd be interested in your views on whether a banker's code of conduct would help to restore public trust in the financial system.
Yeah, I think this was a point made by the Lord Mayor, and banking, like the medical profession or engineering or architecture, is a profession with a proud and long history, and the best practitioners in it are people who are absolutely aware that they want to enhance that professional status, make sure that it's not just properly regulated by the likes of us, but probably regulated by the industry itself, just as the great professions have been over the centuries in this country. And there is a very good initiative going on with the Banking Standards Board to make sure that codes of conduct are up to date, that the training that bankers receive and the exams they have to pass and the like reflect the ethical standards expected of good banking. And, I'd make a broader point, which is if anyone thinks that being unethical in the financial services industry is a good way to make money, I would suggest they look at the very, very large fines that a number of institutions have had to pay. Indeed, in some cases, fines that have potentially at times jeopardized the future of those companies, and ask themselves whether it was worth it, whether the extra buck they made on the trading floor was worth the multi-billion dollar fine they got and the threat to the entire future of the firm. And there's a job for the management there and a job for the shareholders to have a regard to what makes financial sense for that company as well as what's good for society. So I think the best in the banking industry understand that and are showing leadership on it, but understandably the public want to see the proof in the pudding. They want to see the improved standards. They want to make sure that the benchmarks really are open, transparent and non-manipulated, and that the banks are working for their customer. But in the end, the market is also driving this as well as the regulators. Let's take another question. There's a question there, and then I'll come.
Chancellor, you mentioned the renminbi. How can Chinese policymakers achieve the economic rebalancing they desire without a somewhat weaker exchange rate? And what might be the implications for global markets?
Well, you've got two central bankers here, so you can ask them about the exchange rates. I would make a broader point, which is China is undergoing a major economic reform, and it's a reform that essentially we need to support them on. They're moving from this investment-driven economy, export-driven economy, to a consumption-led economy, and they're trying to internationalize their currency. That's why the offshore market of the renminbi is flourishing here in the UK, and we have quasi-sovereigns issuing bonds here, and indeed the sovereign now indicating it will issue bonds here. And of course, their currency has had more flexibility around it. Of course, you know, one of the ironies about the recent discussion about the Chinese currency is about, not allowing it to devalue as much as people expect it might have. That's a different kind of conversation than we used to have about the Chinese currency. So things are changing. Let me take two final questions. This lady and then this gentleman.
My name is Penny Sophocles, and your comments around accountability do suggest that actually there's quite a lot of obfuscation around it, because accountability when LIBOR rigging and foreign exchange is rigged, the financial penalties go to the institution, not to the individuals.
Yeah.
When you speak about accountability of the banks failing and the taxpayers having to pick up the bill, actually the accountability is with the chancellors and the politicians who had to make those decisions. So actually there is more clarity, that needs, there is more direct accountability that must be made.
Well, look, obviously, as an elected politician, I take accountability, I'm accountable for the laws that I recommend to Parliament and that Parliament passes. And ultimately, you know, I appoint the senior regulators, and the regulators are then accountable for the job they do. And the managers in the firms are accountable for the people that they employ and how they do their business as well. And that's why we have the senior managers regime. So you're right to ask the question, you know, have we got the right laws, and therefore the politicians been doing their job? I mean, the truth is, I don't think we had the right laws. And when the LIBOR manipulation took place, it turned out we did not have the criminal laws on the statute book to deal with that scandal, frankly. And some criminal charges have been brought, but not as many as would have been the case if the laws were better. And you know, my responsibility as the person who was there when this scandal was uncovered and it happened over previous years has been to change the laws, and we have now brought in new criminal offences for benchmark manipulation. And as from March next year, senior bankers whose decisions cause banks to fail will face up to 7 years in prison. So those laws are coming in and have been introduced, and they weren't there in the past, but when I got into the job and found out about the scandal, I changed the laws. Who's got another question, sir?
Yes, I think you've answered part of it anyway. The question was going to be along the lines of people taking responsibility. I've been immensely impressed with your analysis, Mark's analysis, of what went wrong. As a member of the public, I'm very impressed with that. As a panellist, I happen to know that the Bank of England has actually got views from outside this particular forum, and although their colleagues and people they've explained what's happening, are appreciative of what the solutions are and what's... The fact is that the general public at large still think, don't trust financial services. Taking a quick straw poll about why that should be, it seems as though that the people who actually were responsible for that never paid any penalty. And I wondered what your views might be about that.
Look, it's perfectly understandable. Indeed, I share some of this frustration and anger. It's perfectly understandable why the public feel the way they did. You know, we were told, here was this well-regulated industry, people were paid high salaries in it because they ran big risks, and if things went wrong, they'd lose their jobs, and they wouldn't get any rewards for what they'd done. And then along comes a big banking crash, and it turns out that the person behind all of this is the taxpayer. The person standing behind the bank is the taxpayer. And whilst, you know, you if you go and, you know, shoplift at the local WH Smiths, you go to prison, but you're the market trader on the trading floor of a big investment bank and you rip off people to the tunes of millions of pounds, there are no criminal offences available to deal with you. So there was a lot of totally understandable anger. And I think people in the banking system often ask me, and have done over the last 5 years, you know, when's it all going to end and can't we just move on? You know, this was the biggest single economic crash of our lifetimes. This was a financial crash probably larger than any experienced since the Victorian age in our country, and an economic crash and a recession as great as anything since the 1930s. So the idea that, you know, just a couple of years on, you can go, oh, well, let's forget about all of that and move on, you know, I think is, a bit optimistic. It's going to take time, and the financial services sector, and indeed the regulators and the politicians responsible, you know, have to prove to the public that things really have changed. There are tougher laws and tougher regulation, and people who commit crimes go to prison. The banking system, if it gets into trouble or individual banks get into trouble, will be bailed out by their creditors rather than by the taxpayers, and that there will be openness and transparency. All I can say is that a huge amount of progress has been made. And in the end, you know, think about, let me end where I started. Think about this event today. You know, central banks are by their nature and because of the nature of the decisions they have to take, quite often closed institutions that don't like to talk too publicly about what they do except in very controlled events and occasions, such as when they publish minutes of monetary policy meetings. What Mark and his team at the bank are trying to do is to have this interactive conversation so that you understand all the pressures and the considerations that the regulators and the central bankers are undertaking. You can hear from people in the financial services industry, you can hear from the politicians, and you can suggest you make your suggestions about where you think we've got it right and where we got it wrong. You know, Mark, in his opening speech, was very explicit about that. He says, I'm not pretending we've got everything right. We're here to listen. Maybe we've overdone some things or underdone other things. You tell us. And this forum today, with all the fact it's connected with other cities in our country, schools around our country, the wide range of people who've turned up today, you know, is a really determined effort by the central bank to have that conversation and try and help the process of restoring trust in our financial system. And I'm pleased to be part of it. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you please remain seated? The panel session will shortly begin.
Yeah, I'll be standing on the side. Yeah.
Okay, so where's the plaque?
That's why I put it on this side, and it's there.
That's brilliant, Stephanie. Okay. Well done, thank you.
This is so open, this forum, and I think we've achieved the goal of the bank, which was to make this unlike any other event hosted by the Bank of England. That means there are quite a lot of moving parts, some of which you see moving over the previous few seconds. You'll be very glad to know that unlike many of these things, we cannot run over in this session. We have what was known in my old broadcasting days as a hard stop, which is the Remembrance Day silence. So I will be reliving some of my moments on the 6 o'clock news where they were going into my ear saying, you mustn't, you must stop talking now so we can go to the more important thing, which is the regional news. We will be doing that a bit later. Almost all the key questions about the future of Britain's financial markets and maybe financial markets generally and their relationship with society have been answered by the Governor and the Chancellor. But it would be rather boring if we didn't have things to further discuss for the rest of the day. So this session is supposed to be, I guess, throwing a lot of balls, issues and themes up into the air and hoping that at least some of you are able to catch them in some of these breakout sessions later on. We have a very broad panel, again, not necessarily one that you would normally get at these kind of sessions. Starting on my right, you have Julia Black, Pro-Director of Research at London School of Economics. Next to her, Professor David Kynaston, the definitive historian of the city and more recently, post-war Britain. We have, I'm looking to see where people are sitting. We have a living, breathing member of the financial sector actually on the panel. So, for a while, it looked like we might not be anybody who actually works in financial services. But we thought maybe
still
just
smiling.
One.
Smiling at the moment.
Me, yeah. Half member in my current capacity. Helena Morrissey, Chief Executive of Newton Investment Management. Lord Jim O'Neill, now Commercial Secretary of the Treasury, but of course for many years at Goldman Sachs. And Rabbi Baroness, Julia Neuberger, now senior rabbi at the West London Synagogue, but I guess for full disclosure, I should also say my religious studies teacher. Whether anyone will be able to see my religious education in anything I've done, I'm not sure. But we were also going to be joined a little bit later, a couple of times, by Nicola Smith, the head of economic and social affairs at the TUC, who's in Birmingham with a collection of interested parties there. People involved in small business and larger business and have an interest in the financial sector and how it's working for people. So we're going to go live to Birmingham a couple of times as well. There is no end to the excitement in this session. Before I let the panellists do anything kind of normal like speaking and having a conversation about these things, we're going to have first a little video where we talk to, yes, real people, what is known in the BBC as Vox Pops, voice of the people. We ask them first what financial markets were for, because sometimes that's the most important question to ask, and wondering whether they're actually going to do a good job.
What do you believe financial markets are there for?
Make a profit. The end of the day.
I think they're there to make a profit, they're a business, I think.
I personally think they're there to make a profit for themselves.
Yeah, I would agree, yeah.
To help people conduct business.
To make money for themselves.
To provide opportunities for investments and so on.
What role do you think financial markets play in the economy?
I think they dictate a lot of what we do.
In fact, they probably rule the whole country, really.
They can be destructive. And I think when I say destructive, I mean that the financial markets sometimes play to the hands of the already rich. I find that sometimes it's a struggle for a person who is an average income earner to really actually get somewhere, say, even on the property ladder, for example.
Do you believe they support the wider economy?
Yes, I do.
But do you think they are a vital part of the economy?
I think they are. I think they're a very important part of the economy.
Do you think financial markets are effective?
Yes, I believe so. It's the free market and you know, that is what our economy is built on.
Yes, in some respects, but I think they're far too powerful now and control far too much of the economy, whereas other factors should be taken into account.
Yes, I think they can be effective, but again, I think they have to be monitored very closely by the regulatory authorities.
We also, or the
Bank of England, also reached out to a number of different groups in trying to answer, again, some of these basic questions about financial markets. I think the results of some of those surveys, I wouldn't say they're entirely scientific surveys, but a collection of different requests for feedback, talking to school contacts, some of the people in schools involved in the Bank of England activities, also to Bank of England's direct contacts and agents, and people who contributed to their website poll on these issues. And we have, as I say, you've got some of the results in your pack, I think, but there's also word clouds, which were, again, sort of showing the importance of different words used when we asked people whether what kind of role they believed financial markets played in society. See, we have webinars, we have word clouds. And I think, you know, one of the, I guess you wouldn't have to look at those very long to decide that people thought they were quite important. And that's probably a good starting, as good a starting point as any. They're important, Julia Black. Why are they important? The most basic question, which sometimes elicits the most interesting answers. What are financial markets for? Why do we care about them so much? But what is their basic job that we need them to do in the economy?
I mean, the basic job that they need to do for us as individuals is to help us live financially secure and prosperous lives. What we want to be able to do is, very simply, we want to be able to pay for things, we want people to be able to pay us. We want to be able to save for the future, we want to be able to save for our children, we want to be able to protect ourselves from risks that we don't want to have to take, ranging from a burst water pipe to long-term healthcare. So without financial markets that really work in a way that we want, we cannot achieve most of the things we want to do in our lives. They are a means to all the very different ends that we may have, and they are absolutely critical for us.
And from an economic standpoint, there's also that more basic idea that you're trying to make sure that the big pot of savings that exists and comes out of different parts of the economy is actually then channeled to the most effective uses. I mean, it's part of having a productive economy, it's part of achieving growth.
It is exactly that transfer, as you say, from my savings into an investment in somebody else's business, into somebody else's trading, somebody else's dreams that they want to achieve, which is critical. But I think what we don't see as individuals is the upstream part. We're very much at the downstream end. So we have a bank account, we have a savings account. We don't really understand what happens to that money once we've put it where we've put it. What other people do with our money, which for them is other people's money. Just as we don't really understand where our coffee has come from or how our cars have been put together, those production chains, those production lines. But what we have to understand is it is a system. And if that whole system is to function properly, every part of it has to function effectively, and it has to function fairly, and it has to function for us.
And I guess it's also a question of which bits of that system do we need to maybe understand better, and which bits, so is it okay to leave opaque, just as we don't know how our iPhone works or our iPad really works. That, I guess, it brings us on to this idea of whether they're doing a good job, and I guess some of the concerns that the Chancellor was mentioning and the Governor was mentioning, this general dissatisfaction with the way the financial markets have worked. You know, we often think it's a new thing, David Kynaston, this idea that the city doesn't really, well, the city's too concerned with its own stuff, and it's too sophisticated, too global, not helping proper industry in other parts of the UK. And then you see that the first report on this subject was actually in the late 19th century. You had things like the Macmillan Committee in 1930s. This is not a new thing.
We have been here before. I was trying to work it out. I mean, if we reckon this is a real, over the last eight years or so, a real wave of external criticism, scrutiny of the city and the markets. I guess this is the fourth wave in the last century and a half. Go back to the 1870s, there was rampant stock market speculation, led to Anthony Trollope writing his wonderful novel, The Way We Live Now, a really searing critique, led to a Royal Commission on the Stock Exchange, which recommended that the Stock Exchange be open to public viewing. It was duly from 1953. Between the wars, disastrous return to the gold standard in 25, led to the Labour government setting up the McMillan Committee, which identified the McMillan gap, the finance of medium-sized companies. And eventually, actually, that sort of anti-city mood led to the nationalisation of the Bank of England itself in 1946, although that post-war Labour government, the Attlee government, did very, very little about the city generally. And then in the 1970s, the whole finance industry debate really went into overdrive, led to the Wilson Committee. But by the time the Wilson Committee reported, fairly innocuously anyway, apart perhaps from identifying the size and the unaccountability of the pension funds, it was 1980, it was the Thatcher government, and that particular government was not going to listen all that carefully to a committee chaired by Harold Wilson. And that was really the last wave. And I mean, since then, the tide, you know, for the 25 years, the 80s, the 90s, the first half of the 2000s, the tide flowed very much in the city's direction and the market's direction in all sorts of ways before the sort of juddering halt in 07-08, and we're then into a whole new phase, and it is the fourth wave, and maybe actually I think the most sustained wave and the most interesting wave of scrutiny that the city and the markets have ever come under.
But do you think, is that partly driven by the times we live in, the technology, the sophistication of markets, or is it to do with just greater scrutiny of everything?
I mean, it's partly that. I think it is partly that. I think that, you know, we are no longer such a deferential society, and at least in theory, we're a more informed society. And I think that's crucial because it's often struck me when I was doing my history of the city and so on, but there are these two great barriers in terms of the outside world and the city. One was that very traditional perception, perhaps no longer the case, that the city was a rather boring place. Monty Python used to have a sketch, didn't they? The dull life of the city stockbroker or something like that. I don't think you'd quite get that now. But of course, the other perception was that they're incomprehensible. And many educated people would have these two huge blind spots. One would be about science, and the other would be about finance and the city. You know, and I think that's starting to change. But even so, I suspect they remain quite high barriers to understanding, actually.
I should say, we're not going to have sort of opening statements from everyone, but I don't know whether there was anything that the rest of you wanted to add on this point of, on, is there less, or is there more focus now on how it is that financial markets work, rather than just that it's somehow they're doing a less good job? And what's different about now?
I do think there is, I think there's a greater focus on it, partly because I think we all feel slightly more involved. We now realise that our pension fund, in fact, has been investing in the markets. I think we understand the links better, but we don't understand how it works as the public. And I think that means we've got to focus without understanding. That actually is a problem, I think, for wider society.
But isn't it just that, you know, when everything's going all right, no one really cares very much, and they don't even necessarily care that people are making a lot of money. You know, there was some concern or outrage about the big salaries before, in the boom years or the semi-boom years, but you don't feel like any of that really caused that reaction until you had the financial crisis. Isn't it just a quite basic thing of, if it works, nobody cares about it?
I'm not quite sure that's true, because I certainly was the food for a large number of novels looking at excess in the boom years. So I'm not sure that people weren't aware there was a boom. They weren't very comfortable with the behaviour of quite a lot of people, and they certainly weren't comfortable with the high salaries. But of course, they become much more concerned when they get a crash and they realise that their own funds, their own pensions, have suffered as a result.
I met someone at JPMorgan whose father had been a bond trader in New York in the 60s, but because he had several children, he also had to drive a subway at night to make ends meet, which you can't quite imagine now. You have to be a true tube driver as well as a bond trader in order to bring up a family in New York.
Not many of those left. No.
Exactly. Yes, you mentioned in your remarks, you know, the transparency, the technology that does mean that everything is open, that being in charge is not what it used to be. You can't tell people what to do. You have to demonstrate by behaviour. So I think the combination of that with the all too sort of in people's faces awareness of the financial costs resulted with bad behaviour is, you know, a very corrosive combination, and we probably still haven't recovered from that.
Well, I think it's probably, might be a good time to head up to Birmingham. I say this with trepidation, hoping that we will be able to go up to Birmingham. But I know that Nicola Smith has already had some conversations with the people there, that she'll also, I think, tell us a bit more about
who she has joining her and thinking about these issues. But Nicola, are you there?
I certainly am here, and I'm here in Birmingham with a range of representatives from the local economy, representing business and the workforce across the Midlands. And we've had a really helpful and useful introductory discussion here, which highlighted both the vital role that financial markets play for businesses and for individuals across the region, but also the realities that people here are still, of course, living with the very severe consequences of the financial crisis in terms of the cuts they've had to their jobs and their pay, the problems that businesses have faced, and of course, the ongoing cuts to public services that we're seeing. I think there's also some concern in the room about whether financial markets are fully achieving the important purpose that people here think they have to play, and also about whether the risks that we saw in the crisis are truly gone, about whether the economy that they're now supporting is really much different from that we saw before the crash, and of course, whether there are in fact new problems that have arisen. But rather than me summarising that discussion, I've got a range of people here with me, and they're all very keen to contribute to the debate. So I'd like to bring in a few contributions from the room, if I can. First of all, up to Norman here, who works for the local enterprise partnership, and is going to talk a little bit about the vital role of financial markets in supporting business lending.
Hi, I'm working and supporting a local enterprise partnerships in finance for business. And we're particularly concerned that in the concentration on financial markets and financial performance, there seems to be a drift away from the economic performance and the social performance, which we consider to be inherently part of our financial system. The effect of that is being particularly felt, I think, on the small business. Big business, I think, is fine, and the markets work quite well. But if you want to raise below £500,000, it's just very difficult for the banks because they're trying to optimise their financial return. They can't cope with the risks of small businesses, so they move away or they don't offer. And that's particularly important for businesses in the Midlands, which are really trying to grow, particularly the small ones, and to grow like that. So we need an understanding that this economic risk should be taken. And if it can't be taken by the banks, then we need some public understanding, as public as well. We all want to generate wealth and economic value for ourselves and for the region. And that actually is part of the risk issue. But if it comes to society, we cannot just let the cost be in the financial institutions. So there needs to be this relationship between helping business to do what is economically sensible and community, not just maximising financial return for the banks. And we're working on that, and there are some special activities there in terms of funding which will be developed even further.
Thanks very much, Norman. And I also had a contribution from David, who wanted to talk about some of the risks that he feels are still inherent in the system despite the role of markets in lending to business.
Thank you. Yes, my name is David. I'm involved in a black country business, and my biggest involvement, and it has been touched on, is with our pension scheme. I'm not a market person, but I need absolute confidence, if transparency, in the working of markets. How can you guarantee, not just demonstrate, guarantee we have this? Thank you.
Thanks, David. And I had a final contribution from Rob, who represents people at work across the Midlands, and I think wanted to talk a bit about the role that markets should be playing in supporting decent jobs and growth.
Yes, thank you. The question to what financial markets should be doing, for us in the Midlands, it should be really working towards securing regional development. Since 2010 and 2014, job growth is three times faster in London than it was here in the Midlands. We've seen a real squeeze on wages. Birmingham Northfield, which used to be the home to the Rover manufacturing plant, is now the low-wage capital of the country, with more than half of people paid less than living wage. And we're seeing just recently the problems around steel and JCB job losses just recently. So there's a real worry that we're actually slipping back and we're not going to secure the growth that we all need. If the Midlands and Birmingham is going to be the engine of growth in the UK economy, we do need to see the financial services sector working to secure good jobs, infrastructure and an active industrial policy which can grow the region and ensure they have a more equal and equitable country.
So I think in summary from Birmingham, financial markets are really important, but there's probably a lot more they should be doing, and that there doesn't seem to be an enormous amount of confidence in the room that they're fully achieving their potential or being as effective as they could be at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Nicola. I was sort of interested to hear people actually feeling the banker's pain there, saying that it's actually, you know, you need to take risk and it's very difficult for the banks. I'm sure that many people in the room don't always get that sense around the financial sector. But you know, the one thing that's already been mentioned, and we heard mentioned earlier about the code of conduct, we seem inevitably to move from questions of the effectiveness of the financial sector to questions of ethics and conduct. And in a sense, one shouldn't find this so surprising. I mean, one of my colleagues says, of course, this is all about a relationship business, because whatever part of the financial sector you're in, if you're dealing with individuals or companies, it's really about saying, give me your wallet. Give me your wallet, and I'll give it back to you at some later point. And depending on what bit of the financial sector you're in, you're going to give it back with more money in or less money in. But it is all about that trust. So inevitably, there's going to be questions around ethics and behaviour, which maybe don't arise in other sectors. We asked our Populi members on the high street, do financial markets work in the interests of society? Let's hear that and then get on to that discussion.
How much do you think financial markets work in the interests of society as a whole?
Probably not really very much. I think they're in
these
business
folks,
to make money for themselves and their investors.
Definitely not. It's all about lining the pockets of corporations and governments. It's not about the average man at all. It never has been.
I wouldn't thought so particularly. No, it's very commercial, very capital focused, very profit orientated.
Yeah, I think they do it.
Not really. No, not at all.
No, not at all.
I don't. I think they work in line with the pockets of the really big guys in the banks. I mean, their bonuses sometimes are so exorbitant, it's just mind-blowing, to be honest.
I think that financial markets work in the interest of some of society. I think they're there to make money for people, essentially. I don't think they're there to look after a society, maybe like they should do.
Not really.
Whose interests do you think they work in?
Themselves. Whoever they may be.
Do you have any confidence that they can work in the interests of wider society?
No. No, not really.
So that's all right then. I do know, Julia, Rabbi Neuberger, I do know some bankers who were rather relieved when the Volkswagen scandal broke. Because they felt maybe people will be reminded that other people do bad things too.
I think they certainly were a little relieved. I think for purposes of full disclosure, since you've revealed that I once taught you religious studies, I ought to reveal that my grandfather was a banker. Clearly people were relieved by Volkswagen. Actually, I think they were also relieved by some of the revelations about BP. And many years ago, of course, bankers, also sometimes criticised for huge salaries at that date, were quite relieved by distillers and the thalidomide case. So I think, you know, you could go back in history and you can look at times that bankers have been criticised over actually quite a lot of generations about some forms of behaviour, have been somewhat relieved to see that other sectors have had the same problems. And the trouble is, though, that it quite often comes back to bankers nevertheless.
Yeah, and I guess part of me sort of thinks, okay, maybe they are held to a higher standard. I mean, that's often the complaint. But shouldn't they be held to a higher standard? I mean, isn't this about people's money? And maybe there's actually a greater, even a greater temptation, greater scope for misconduct.
Well, there clearly is greater scope for misconduct in certain environments, but I'm not an expert, and that other people, Helena particularly, can talk better about that. But it does seem to me that they should be held to a high standard. And we were hearing earlier about bankers being a profession. and the Banker's Code, but I think that that needs to be driven up a long way. Seems to me that you can draw a good parallel with the medical profession. My expertise is largely looking at professionals from the outside, so I've been on the General Medical Council and I'm not a doctor, and I've looked at nursing and I'm not a nurse. And one of the things that happens is that professionals, however professional they are and however good their codes of conduct, have an awful tendency to talk to each other a lot of the time. And therefore, they think that what they're saying is the norm and is probably okay. And it's only really when outsiders come in and say, but are you really sure that that's the right way to do things? And let me give you a good example and a recent one that people here will know about. I chaired the review of the Liverpool Care Pathway into how we look after people who are dying in this country. And it was perfectly clear that a large number of the nurses and the doctors were not using the code properly, were not using the regulations properly, but thought that they were doing the right thing. And when you started asking the question, they would start saying, oh, yeah, maybe it's not such a good idea if people are asking for a drink not to give them one. And I just found that absolutely extraordinary. And I think it's that point you need to open up. And when we talk about transparency, that's not the same as openness. Openness means allowing other people in. It means allowing in the fresh air. And it can be very uncomfortable. And I don't think bankers yet are a professional group as I would understand it with, say, doctors and lawyers. And doctors and lawyers have found it uncomfortable.
Well, actually, on that point about questions, I should have mentioned quite a long time ago, but some of you have already started asking questions anyway, that you should all be contributing questions. And I will. They're going to come up on my iPad. But if we have time, I will actually call on you to put your questions. We've also got questions coming in from Twitter, so please do keep those in, and we'll try and throw them in where relevant. Helena, I mean, one of the first things, in fact, my first few days at JP Morgan on the asset management side were spent explaining to me the concept of fiduciary duty. You know, it is quite a big deal, particularly in asset management, but how do you respond to what Julia has said and generally a lot of these questions around conduct?
So I think, first of all, even though I'm obviously the only person that didn't get the memo and I'm the one financial practitioner up here, I'm not going to defend the indefensible. I think that we have had huge regulatory reform and that has been great, but as Julia's already pointed out, what we need to now do is embed that into how we behave. It's a bit like, I have to use a personal example, I'm a mother to an awful lot of children, actually, I'll rephrase that, a wonderful lot of children.
I was priding myself on not mentioning that.
No,
in my
well, I'm only
going to
mention it in the context of when you're, or any parent will know, obviously, when you bring up children, you are trying to cultivate a sense within them of right and wrong. But you don't have to prescribe every eventuality. Once you get to a certain point, there's an awareness and they start behaving a certain way. Although, actually, yesterday, having tried to book them out, but buy a book on Amazon and discovering £384 of items that one of the children had put in the basket, hoping they wouldn't notice. I'm
not
sure.
Can I ask you, when is
that
point that happens, that they start doing things without you telling them?
Well, I guess I say that it can vary from child to child. I'm going to just say it like that. But clearly, what we've had at the moment since the financial crisis, we've had an awful lot of rules put in place to try to reform. Today is about, I think it's a great mirror on us today. As Julia said, we tend to look too much amongst ourselves. We talk to each other. We say, aren't we so much better than we were before? It's quite introspective. And even perhaps regulators come to us because we are the practitioners, perhaps relatively expert, and sort of, you know, echo some of the things that they hear. So it's a very closed shop. Today is about holding up a mirror. And unfortunately, at the moment, I think it's more like we've had a makeover, but underneath it all, it's not still looking that great. And so fiduciary duty, just for those who, you know, we didn't go back to that, you know, it's quite an arcane sounding concept, but actually all it's about is about behaving responsibly as you look after someone else's interests. But that would be a good example right now where if you talk to asset manager professionals about it, immediately goes into sort of legalistic conversation and people get very sort of het up about what it specifically, the boundaries are. Whereas we need to get back to what the principle of it is and our customers. We are too far away from our clients. There are too many links in the chain. We very rarely, apart from big pension funds, sit with our clients and hear them. And that's why, you know, it's great today that we are, however uncomfortably, having that mirror held up against us.
I mean, we often talk about transparency in these contexts and John Kenneth Galbraith used to say that a conscience was just the fear that somebody else might be watching. You know, that's the basic idea around transparency. But Julia's mentioned that it's also about openness and being open to other things. But, I mean, Jim, I put you on the spot a bit. I mean, I do wonder whether there's a further issue here, which is not just about things being in the open, but actually that the way practitioners see some of the things they do is just fundamentally different from the way that outsiders do it. And the great example of this was some of the cases after the financial crisis involving market making and the creation of instruments purely really to allow one side of the market to bet against them. And that was one of those classic examples where the people involved in it, in the financial institution, said, well, that's market making. We were doing that efficiently. That's our job. And when if people understood that, surely they wouldn't mind. And then, but actually, the problem was once you explained that to people, they thought it sounded rather bad. They actually thought it didn't sound like a great thing to do. It sounded like betting and a bit dodgy. You know, isn't that part of the thing that when you can make things transparent, some of it was about just transparency, but other bits was just actually there was things going on that people in the rest of society actually didn't think was very valuable.
Well, first of all, I'd add my own congratulations to the governor and all his team for putting on something like this, because my real answer to your question is I don't know if I or anybody knows the answers to many of these things. And linked to something you said early on, and I think Helena touched on it, some aspects of the related dilemmas is with the age of 24/7 information technology, that the famous a little bit of information thinks you know a lot, and it makes it all a lot more demanding for everybody, both for those observing about the role of financial services and for those that are in it, in a good and a bad sense. If I come to the sort of specifics of what you really are aiming at there, when I was leaving my old life, I found myself, when I was quizzed as to what I reflect back on, I used to say people should get on the tube more often. Because, and I suspect it's not just true in the financial world, in any highly, especially the international part, highly technical related world where everybody's talking to each other, you have this group thing where you're just increasingly with the people that you are with. And I don't think it's in the slightest bit healthy in financial services, nor is it in many other parts of the world. And one of the things that the Chancellor touched on, Philip touched on it a bit last night at dinner, the Governor have as well, is especially from a domestic British perspective, getting more competition and different sorts of financial institutions seems to me to be a substantive path to go down. I smiled to myself as I was listening to what you were saying, because one of the other things I'm doing in my life at the moment, I have been doing for the past year, is that I'm leading an independent review into antimicrobial resistance. And whilst we all have bankers are kind of regarded down here and doctors quite rightly up here, one of the huge problems in that world is overprescription of antibiotics by the medical profession. So, you know, lots of professions do things perhaps not as well as they should do. And because of the scale of the, as the Chancellor touched on, it reminded us all that the horrific size of the economic collapse that we went through, it is right that we're trying to explore why the hell was it so bad and what were people doing particularly badly. But I think we have to be, in the notion of being transparent and open, I think we have to also accept that we might not fully know, and the idea that we find some magical solutions that are going to be with us forever for the next generation, I think is actually quite dangerous. At the end of the day, as you also touched on and a number of others have, financial institutions in aggregates, in essence, are there to stand between excess savings and people that need them. And we can put in whatever we want in place, but so long as everybody doesn't always have just the right savings that they need and there's nobody that wants to borrow, there's always going to be some form of financial intermediary. So I didn't really answer your question, but I think trying to get from a British perspective, more different kinds of financial institutions doing for the broad domestic UK economic needs, whether it's an individual or a small company or a large company, is a very important thing. And part of the problem, in my view, in 08 is that more and more financial institutions that were called different things were kind of trying to do too much of the same.
Actually, there is a question that's come in on that, a number of questions actually related to that. You know, one question from Josh Ryan Collins, who I think is here. So the UK is dominated by very large shareholder-owned banks headquartered in London. Is this a sensible banking ecosystem for supporting SMEs and businesses? And there's several other questions that are actually contrasting the way that small businesses are supported here relative to other parts of the continent. I mean, does anyone want to come in on that, or how you might address that? I guess even as part of the Northern Powerhouse.
So I was smiling with the interviews from Birmingham, I guess, because I'm actually going to be there myself on Thursday in further ongoing discussions about devolution. And I think it was mentioned earlier, and from my own hometown of Manchester, it's nice to see Williams and Glynn name reappearing. I remember as a child in a part of Manchester where I lived, Williams and Glynn had a branch. And I think one of the many exciting things about the devolution agenda, and not just for the Northern Powerhouse, but for many parts of the country, is the notion of different, linked to what I was just saying, different forms of finance that might be specialist for that region or even originate from that region, whether it be local VC firms from an equity perspective or renewed forms of more traditional banking types. And of course, there's the whole world of fintech. Quite a bit of the creative part of the fintech thing, encouragingly, is going on from the Northeast, as I'm sure many people here know. All of these things are really good developments.
It's a good, I should pass on to you that the message about the question about the Northern Powerhouse, there is some concern that it seems very government-led at the moment. I mean, you can't really win if you're the government, because either it's not government-led enough, or it's too government-led. But anyway, there is that. I should pass that on from the audience. It's a good opportunity to go back to Birmingham, I think, briefly, because I know that Nicola has also been talking to the people there about this sort of broader ethical issue, as well as, you know, whether they're doing an effective job, the financial markets, in that part of Britain. So, Nicola.
Thanks very much, Stephanie. I mean, I think it's fair to say that the view from the TUC is very much that ethics are not an extra add-on, that they're absolutely central to the effectiveness of financial markets, you know, whose core purpose has to be serving society. And if markets are allowing huge risks to build up, they're effectively not doing their job properly. And I think it's also true that across society, while we've seen a lot more focus on regulation of the financial sector in recent years, there is a broad sense that the structure of the economy that financial markets are supporting and the way that they're working may not be that different from what it looked like before. We're still seeing very large pay packets in the financial sector back to where they were before the crisis, while ordinary people's wages are still very far below where they would be if growth had continued at pre-crisis rates. We're still seeing corporate governance systems that put shareholders first and don't include the voice of wider stakeholders, including employees. We're seeing the vast majority of lending going back into the financial sector. Trends that we saw before the crisis have simply been exacerbated, while manufacturing at the moment in the UK is technically in recession. And we're still seeing problems with excessive fees and charges. So despite a lot of focus on improving the regulatory environment, I think it's fair to say that many people's view would be that the structure of the economy that financial markets are helping create may not be that different. And actually, the ways that things are being done may not look to many people to be much different from how it was previously. But again, this isn't about me and my views. It's about all the people here in the room in Birmingham. And I thought I might just repeat an exercise we did earlier where we asked people to give us an indication of their views of the risks that financial markets can cause if they don't operate with a view to ethics. So I'm going to ask people in the room again if they can give me a show of hands on a couple of questions. Firstly, I would like people to put their hand up if they think that financial markets had a key role in causing the financial crisis and the recession that we experienced in the UK.
near unanimous support for that opinion. And can I also ask people if you are now confident that financial markets are operating in an ethical way that would prevent such a crisis and a recession hitting us here again? So, a fairly clear view from the room in Birmingham here, both about the incredible risk that financial markets created for the economy here, and also about a real concern that we may not have got in place the measures that would prevent that sort of severe consequence for people's pay and living standards and jobs hitting us in the future. But we do, as I said, have a broad agreement in the room that financial markets are crucially important for supporting growth and jobs, and we've also got a diversity of views about what it is that would allow us to move towards those more ethical ways of working, which would reduce the risks that financial markets pose. So I'd like to go to a few more contributions in the room on that theme, and firstly to John, who has got an important point he'd like to make.
My name is John Kelly. I'm a chartered accountant and corporate recovery partner, and I've been dealing with distressed businesses now for nearly 40 years. And I feel as though I'm in a minority in believing that we should stop bashing the banks, to be honest, and move on. There is some great expertise in banking, and we sometimes forget about that. We need that expertise to regain its confidence so that the banks and their expertise can play their proper part in business support and the wider economy. I also believe we need to get back to having more realistic interest rates, because I think the economy at the moment is based on quite unrealistic rates. Thank you.
Thanks, John. So John's view that we really need to see a better dialogue between society and the banking sector to get back towards more ethical practice. And also Brian had an important point to make about the consequences of the crisis and what that's actually meant for people here in the Midlands.
Yes, good morning. My name is Brian Murphy. I represent a national mortgage brokerage across the UK. The point I'd really like to make first and foremost is that we deal with most of the financial institutions, both banks, building societies and specialist finance houses, for the provision of mortgage finance for consumers. I would certainly say that the, shall we say, moral compass of all the people that we deal with within those institutions is incredibly high. I have no issue with that whatsoever. I think one of the consequences that we've seen as a result of the financial crisis is that there was some, shall we say, inappropriate lending back in 2006-07. But I also think there was a role that the regulator at that time failed to play in terms of actually reining that type of practice in. I think one of the unintended consequences of that, though, is that we now have an extremely regulated marketplace within the mortgage market. And I think as a consequence of that, we have a lot of lenders really sitting very much in the mainstream. So nobody's really prepared to sit outside, be an outlier, so to speak, and cater for certain sectors of the market. So from our perspective, we would say that there are significant sectors or swathes of the country or consumers who are underserved in terms of access to mortgage finance, in particular perhaps older borrowers, and also perhaps people that arrange mortgages originally through self-certification, but they're now largely excluded from refinancing or moving on in their sort of home purchase environment due to the restrictive nature of the environment we work within.
Thanks, Brian. And we had one final contribution from Birmingham from David, who wanted to talk a bit about ownership models and the important role they play in promoting ethical behaviour.
Good morning, everybody. I'm David Marlowe, the Chief Executive of the Nottingham Building Society. I just wanted to go back to a point that was raised to the panel a little earlier about ownership models. And I think to understand the importance of ethics in financial services, we need to go back to what our core business is about. And the core business is about serving two diametrically opposite needs. I have savers who want the absolute maximum amount of interest that they can get on their savings, and I have customers who want to borrow that money and pay as little interest as they can possibly get away with as well. And it's our job to stand in the middle and to balance those needs. So you only have to look at the ownership models to understand the challenges that that can bring. If I'm in the business to absolutely make profit from those diametric opposite needs, I will behave and run my business in a particular way. And then obviously to control that, regulation and law is very important. However, I think if we want to get our financial markets operating efficiently, effectively, and going back to being world leading, we need to look at the ownership models that are at play. There's no surprise that mutuals actually excel in financial services, because our driver is to operate our business in a way to keep the balance between mortgage and savings needs as tight as possible. I think it's probably fair to say that the market was operating fairly efficiently post 1980, when mutuals had almost 40 to 50% of the mortgage assets in the country. So I think it's no surprise that you've got different ownership models. So it's good that we see challenger banks coming in and we see new business models. So business models bring diversity, but I think it's also going to be important that we see more diversity in ownership models so that the market can operate more efficiently.
So so to conclude just now from Birmingham, we've still got a high perception of risk in the financial system and a very mixed set of views in the room about what needs to change in the future to make sure that those risks are minimised and financial markets truly serve society, individuals and businesses in the region.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Nicola. I think that was really helpful. We had some really good contributions there. And I think we're then in this last section, I hope going to bring in the audience here a little bit more in thinking about the future. I'm tempted, and I can't resist the temptation, to ask the same question, although I may get the wording slightly wrong, of the audience here. Who here is confident that the changes that have happened in the financial system over the last few years will leave us secure? I'm not sure if it was will prevent another crisis or will leave us secure in the face of another financial crisis. Who feels that job done? Very brave person.
You've got to put your hand up.
Hang on, what? Didn't you just say the job was not done? Yeah, I think the question was a bit fairer, but still elicited a very negative response. It had a very fair question, except it also elicited this, even a rather fairer version of that question, elicited a very negative response, so I don't think it's fair. I guess one of the sort of segues from ethics to the future is around pay. People are very concerned about pay, concerned about behaviour. So before we get onto the final bit of discussion, I don't know about you, but I feel the need for another word cloud. We have one more word cloud to show you from those same sources of outreach to people talking about the financial sector. And this is also a version of that. It was the words that appeared most often in response to the question, are we heading in the right direction? And is it going to become more over time? I wanted to highlight this one because I did think there was a bit of more of a contrast between what the Bank of England's business contacts thought we were heading for and what the unscientific, but nonetheless possibly more real, can we say, respondents to the web thought.
No, I can see it.
I don't know whether that, if you think of the Bank of England business contacts as being better informed, then you can feel reassured that we are in fact going to a more regulated and accountable system, but clearly we've got some way to go on the ethical side. Jim, I won't ask you the impossible question, is the job done, are we all completely safe? But where do you see the key challenges, given that we know a lot of progress has been made on the regulation and we are looking at quite a different financial system now? What's the next frontier, if you like?
Four quick things. First one to repeat something I touched on earlier. I think it is potentially misleading for us to ever think we've got all the answers figured out, because economic and financial crises of some degree tend to happen at some point in the economic cycle. And it will happen again at some point, unfortunately, almost irrelevant of what any of us try and do, is the reality. I think the key thing is we need to make sure that the mechanisms that we have in place mean that the fallout won't be anything like as devastating as what we went through here and in many other parts of the world in 08. Second thing also to reiterate in that regard, I think one of the really encouraging things in my view, the more I think about it and bits I've heard last night and today add to my belief, if we can get more diversity, including genders, but also sorts of financial institutions, particularly for the domestic facing economy, I think that's a very important point. Third thing to say, because it's not being said much by anybody other than the Chancellor briefly, I think it's very important as a nation, because we're quite unique, maybe not the only place in this degree, but we have the importance of the need of the financial system for our domestic interests, and we have this remarkable role that London plays at the centre of the global financial services business. And that is a huge thing of where lots of, whilst there's times where that has been very destructive, including 08, there's huge creative things that come out of that. When I came into finance at the start of the 80s, on the back of the oil surpluses, the American banks here are playing a huge role in terms of recycling that money around the world. And London, because of the time zone, the language, is in a fantastic position. And another thing I'm focused on so heavily in my current life is this massive challenge in infrastructure, both here but globally. And at some point in the next few weeks, months, years, there's going to be people out of finance creating really smart ways of attracting more capital into infrastructure. And we don't want to stop those kinds of things. And London especially can excel in that regard in a global sense. The final thing I would say briefly, which is very much a sort of personal thing, but linking it to the notion of people becoming more diverse, maybe some financial institutions that are not as investment bank in nature as others might want to think about restructuring their businesses to be, let's call it customer relationship divisions as opposed to trading or product related divisions. I don't think you'd want to legislate that for everybody, because for some investment bank types that need to provide a lot of risk, you probably wouldn't want to do that. But for many other organisations that especially are facing a clearer domestic counterparty, something like that, especially for those that want to take some competitive edge on others, that would seem to me an obvious path to pursue.
I mean, one issue that quite a few people have raised, but maybe we don't confront squarely enough, is just this sort of the choices involved here, the tensions here, that you can't necessarily have a completely, and the Chancellor mentioned it, you can't have an entirely safe system that is also very innovative and lacking in sort of cumbersome regulation. I mean, Helena, asset management industry, I think JPMorgan has hired, well, not just in asset management, but I think we've hired 9,000 compliance officers in the last 18 months. You know, there's a tension here.
And there is, and I think a lot of it comes back into how do we better align interests between the industry and society that it's serving. You know, we do have a vested interest in the same result, and whether it be pay, which I think one of the reasons why this terrible sort of dichotomy between, you know, we've got corrupt as the biggest word on the web respondents, and it doesn't appear at all in the Bank of England's business contact. I mean, I think the only reason, or the real thing behind that, is around pay and sort of incentives. Chancellor mentioned, obviously, that people were shocked when thinking that bankers were paid more and other people in the financial services because they're taking greater risk. They didn't have risk on the downside. And I think you've made the challenge, Jim, just now in terms of business model rethinking and diversity of people to get more sort of familiarity with our customers. And again, we're too insulated, but also too similar in the financial markets. And I think all this is about less incremental change and more radical rethink. I think we've done the incremental change, and now we have to radically rethink.
Actually, there was a question in the audience. I might ask you, the Bruce Davis, where are you sitting? Very high risk doing this. Oh, there, okay. Can you wait for a microphone and put your question? Because it relates to some of these points about innovation and regulation.
Yes, Bruce Davis from London, one of the first regulated crowdfunding company in the world. And we invest in the infrastructure. But I guess I also helped create peer-to-peer lending. And I see the direction of travel being different, i.e. decentralizing and fragmenting. And I guess my question around, how do we create more decentralized and fragmented financial systems, I think more resilient, in the face of centralized and increasingly bureaucratic, again, regulation? drift towards the desire to control at the detail level and a lack of trust at the principal level, which is where I thought we started out about 3 or 4 years ago. So I guess the question is, how do we maintain this confidence of regulators to treat us in terms of principles rather than drifting towards rules? Because rules don't work. I'm innovator, I'll work around that, unfortunately. So how do we maintain that principles-based approach to the work?
And I guess, and there's the other end of the spectrum, there's another question which has come in from Twitter, actually, which is just saying, given the growing regulator and tax cost of banking, do you expect to see any new challenger entrants? So it sort of goes from both perspectives. There's a perception that the regulation is so great that only the big banks can really do it. But on the other side of it, there's a question of actually, no, you just want to fragment this. I mean, who wants to respond to that, Julia?
Can I just say something about the enormous regulation? You just said that you'd had 9,000 compliance officers, and it does seem to me that that's... we have huge amounts of regulation. I don't know how many people here have tried to open a charity bank account in recent years. Complete nightmare, because of very understandable regulation. So you're completely right that some of the detailed regulation, some of the bureaucracy isn't helpful, but it does mean going back to principles, and I think that means making bankers actually be a proper profession, and I think we haven't really grasped that. You have to get the principles in, and people have to have a code and be judged against it.
Well, except for, I think, yeah, the point of Bruce Davis's point was somewhat sort of consistent
way.
With actually going the other way, that actually you don't want it to be a club. You want it to be a more fragmented system, but maybe that's also a system that can be more safely fail. I mean, is that consistent
perhaps
with some of the other things that we've talked about?
Well, I think obviously if power is dispersed among different players, then clearly that means that there's less tendency for, like we had in the four big banks, and that being a big problem. But I think your point, Bruce, is extremely well made, but the answer surely is that people demand the access to your crowdfunding or peer-to-peer lending and so forth. And I think that that's where the alignment comes in. Today is about saying, actually, we've had all this regulation. It's maybe protected people already in the established system, but the established system is not the only answer. And actually, perhaps that is the way forward, where you get people, you know, genuinely being able to have a choice. I know from talking to some of the regulators that actually they are trying to recognize the need for innovation, not have the same bureaucracy around smaller up-and-coming players. But obviously, that's very hard to reconcile with the rules for existing incumbents. I think it has to come from people demanding, actually, we need a better selection of opportunities for our money.
Well, there has been a sort of an interesting example in the last few years of peer-to-peer lenders actually requesting regulation and thinking that was quite an important part of their development as a sector. Another piece of this, which I know is going to be discussed in the panels, which has come up in a lot of these questions, is technology, not just, I guess, the positive side of technology, the sort of crowdfunding side, but also the concerns that fed through into some of the fair and effective markets review and other things. Can I ask Tim Andrews, where is he? Ah, sitting right behind the previous person, excellent. Do you want to put your question?
Yeah, it's just really a question about trading and dark pool liquidity and how those kind of things look going forward with the threats that regulators are being very vigilant and sort of behind them early days of that.
I didn't even catch that at all, actually. So, regulators behind the curve.
Are regulators behind the curve in sort of high frequency trading? Where are the other things that you mentioned?
Dark pools,
yeah, some of the sort of Michael Lewis stuff and everything else. I mean, you know, that's another example where you've got super efficiency, super liquidity, you know, the extreme version of things that we actually want, liquidity in markets, actually then seeming to produce a lot of regulatory issues. Jim, do you think that there's a...
It's tricky, as I keep saying. I think, again, as on this, the answer to this, as in many of these things, I would like to think I know what it is. When I hear that kind of question, I first think about the foreign exchange market, which is where I spent so much of my own past, which I always did, and still frequently cite as
in some ways, being the world's biggest fruit and vegetable store. It's open from 9 o'clock on a Sunday night, continuously, our time, continuously through till 10 o'clock on a Friday night. And that has a lot of high frequency trading in it. And of course, its participants within it have been responsible for a pretty indefensible scandal recently. But that the high frequency that goes on in that, not which interestingly didn't appear to contribute to the particular misdemeanor, is hugely necessary for making world trade and capital flow around. And what I think the challenging role for regulators in that case is to somehow, and I don't know how you do it, and there's plenty of them here, along with some aspect of, I guess, what I do now, you've got to be on top of all the interesting innovations at the edge that might relate to that or any other market to make sure it's not going to result in some negative aggregate fallouts, whilst at the same time resist the temptation to regulate just for the sake of it and responding to what happened in the past. And I don't know, you know, well, once the governor and others have found the answer to that, then life will be very easy. But it's not an easy thing. You've got to be so careful on both sides of it.
There's another great question from Twitter now. I'm going to try and find it. Oh, yes. I'm interested in this one. So George Osborne said, the UK wants to have the biggest banks in the world. Do we? That's the question.
Did you say that?
I think that's
well, they've paid quite a fair bit, you know, and that's the new Labour deal, wasn't it? You know, light touch, they pay the taxes. You know, I mean, it was the famous Mandelson quote, writ large, really.
But it comes back, can we bear it? So it comes back to the issue, are they still too big to fail? The bail-in mechanisms which are being developed, will they actually work in a crisis? Will they work, or only one at a time on a relatively small scale? Or will they actually work if everybody or the main players was to go down at any one time? And the answer is, very sadly, we actually just don't know. So there's a certain amount where we just have to kind of, you know, cross our fingers and hope that actually this might work. But it's the shoring up, it's the building in of resilience, it's trying to make sure that those who actually cause the loss suffer the consequences, and you have appropriate accountability, both financial accountability, legal, moral and ethical accountability when things go wrong. And that's what all the efforts have been there for. I think the thing is that really we just won't know until we get that kind of crisis again. So financial markets are all about risk, okay? And risk is meant to go where those who are most able to bear it and those who want to bear it, but also to those who know exactly what risks they actually are bearing at any one time.
And failing that, it goes on to the public sector balance sheet.
Unfortunately.
There's an awful lot of questions. We don't have a lot of time, but I should reflect the fact that there's about half a dozen questions that all relate to pay in one way or another. So I can't find any of them. But is there any real will to do anything about pay? For example, limits on the differential ratios between the top and bottom of companies. Shouldn't we have something that reflects the social usefulness of different parts of the financial markets relative to others? Do you think that the rewards of individuals working in the financial markets are in any way geared to their social usefulness of what they do? Should they be? Very quick response from any of you, a couple of you. Do you think pay is at the heart of this when you talk to people?
Yeah.
It's not been necessarily at the heart of answers because of all the reasonable things that people say about the practicality.
If the city and the financial markets are serious about achieving a genuine social alliance, real action has to be taken on pay, because it remains grotesque disparity between this particular rather hermetic world and most of the outside world. It's grotesque.
And there's a real argument, isn't there, for increasing the amount of activity because of the kinds of charges you can make and the kind of pay you can get, and that therefore that there may be an interest there that isn't in the interest of markets but is in the interest of the individual. So I think there's a huge question about pay, and I do think it has to be tackled.
At the very least, you have to have symmetry. If you have upside for pay, you have to have downside for pay, and I think that's the very starting point.
And you would say that there could be more regulation along those lines, or this is something that's a self-adopted
Well, I think if people are really serious about getting the social license, having a more thriving financial sector in the future, then it would be self-imposed. Regulation ends up being worked around.
Jim?
Well, I'd spent a considerable part of my life in the financial sector in a privately owned partnership in which most of what you earned stayed as capital. And I think for the risk-taking institutions in finance that we still need, something that relates to that model, I think, is important. I'm not sure for the other kinds of models, particularly the ones that are doing simple client-facing things, it is the right model.
I'm going to interrupt you, or at least bring you to a close, so we can all be upstanding, please, to observe the Remembrance Day silence. Thank you very much for that. You must all be getting along to your breakout sessions now. So I think I should bring the session to a close by thanking Nicola in Birmingham and all the excellent contributions we had from her and from her audience. Thanking for you to all your questions and people on Twitter who put forward their questions, and to all the people here on the panel. Martin Wolf on the FT this morning, he threw into his column at the end a comment saying that we should make financial crises small and rare. I think one of the things that you should discuss is whether we could have or should want to have small and rare, or at least whether we can hope to have small and rare, but we could probably at least settle for small financial crisis as the thing that we would like. Thank you very much to all of you, and I hope the rest of the day goes very well.